Shalom, shalom, I need you, Buddha Yoruba. Peace, peace, hello, hello. I'm Judah the Shooter. So, one second, let me take a sip of my soda. Real quick, propolybook.com is where you can get this, all right? You can definitely get that at propolybook.com. Speaking of that, if you have never been to the channel, please like, share, and subscribe. Hit the bell so you can receive the notifications for when I drop another video, ladies and gents. If you don't know who I am, I'm the author of the book, The Unwritten Rules of Polygyny. And the book is for those men and women out there, whether you are for or against the polygynous culture. It's going to clear up a lot of the misconceptions that you may or may not have heard, you know what I'm saying, and definitely questions that you may or may not have had. All right, so definitely get the book, The Unwritten Rules of Polygyny. Definitely make sure you have the revised version, professional editing. You would know if you see that little Hebrew chain in the middle. That's how you'll know if you actually got the book. All right, so once again, propolybook.com. You can definitely get the merchandise, as you you've been seeing in different videos, different color jackets and things like that. We even got the shoes, of course, to match every jacket. See the polygyny on the front, as you see polygyny right there. Got the 23 on the side, of course, you know what I'm saying. So yeah, see the people in the middle of the shoe. Then of course, not only you have the shoe, of course, but then you have the hat to match as well. Then of course the jacket, and of course the shirts as well to match, ladies and gents. You know, on the back of the jacket, I have that on the back as well. I don't know if you ever see that. So it's on the back as well. Propolybook.com is where you can get all of this. Hold on, let me put my phone on silent real quick. All right. So yeah, propolybook.com, The Unwritten Rules of Polygyny. So, let's go ahead and show you real quick, in case you've never been to the channel, of course. YouTube.com/Judah the Shooters, where you can find the videos. I've been doing a lot of polygyny rants, as you know, dealing with various topics, like, of course, the misconception about 1 Corinthians 7 and 2, the misconception about a concubine versus concubines, dealing with that. I've been going over dealing with the misconception about the laws of the land, and the misconception about Exodus 21, 10, and 11. Lawful not expedient in context. Can multiple wives live in the same house? The 1 Timothy 5 and 8 misconception. The Proverbs 27 polygyny myth. Been going over that as well. These are really good videos. The misconception about Ephesians 5, 21. Been going over that. The misconception about 1 Timothy. Third chapter, dealing with a bishop and one wife, of course. Here's another one, polygyny, is it a sin? Going over that. Abraham's wife, Sarah, was she really impatient? Going over that, and that misconception. The misconception about Adam and Eve. That one, of course, again, is called Adam and Eve. They two shall be one flesh, as you see, ladies and gents. I thought I put this phone on silent. But anyway, there's another one I did. Polygyny equals a disappointment to several women. That is most definitely another video to definitely check out, ladies and gents. So, yeah, definitely got a lot of videos on this specific topic. And as you see, I'm not done, because you see the title now, which I'll decide what the title gonna be later. But obviously, you know, by the time you watch the video, you see the title. So you more than likely about know what this video is going to be about and what it's going to be touching on. All right. So once again, ladies and gents, propolybook.com is where you can actually get the book and the merchandise. You can cash app as well. Yeah. So let's see. Is there anything else I want to touch bases on? Yeah, as you know, the flag's for sale. The merchandise and things are for sale once again. That's for sale. All right. Uh-huh. Yeah, so yeah, we're gonna go ahead and get it going, ladies and gents. So strap your seatbelts on, it's about to be another ride. Hopefully you all have been following all of these polygyny series rants. All right, so we're about to do another one. I've already did another video as well. And what was that topic on? I think it was Isaiah, the 4th chapter. I haven't released that video either. I'll be releasing these videos Not sure on when I'm gonna release them, but I should be doing Isaiah 4 video. Isaiah 4 and 1 about the seven women take home to one man. I did a lesson on that as well. So that one will be out before this one. All right, so now that we got that out of the way, I think I told you all everything. Let's go ahead and get this party started. So, Judah, what do we have today, as you may be wondering? All right, what do we have here? First, we're going to go to Deuteronomy 17:17 real quick. Let's go ahead and deal with that. Hold on 1 second. Deuteronomy 17:17. We'll just deal with the actual verse first. We have, of course, those are Rehiru, Valo, Yerbalo, Nashim, Valo, Yasur, Lavavo, Vichesef, Vizahav, Lo, Yerbalo, Meod. But we'll deal with that later, of course. In the English text, it says, neither shall he multiply, we'll deal with first, wise unto himself, that his heart turn not away, neither shall he greatly multiply to himself silver and gold. All right, so one of the first questions I usually ask those who are in the anti-poly community is, are you good at math first? And are you good with the terms of math? Because if you are, then you will quickly see that maybe you might be reading too fast. So you might ask, well, what do you mean by that, Judah? Okay, first let's deal with things like actual terms. We're gonna go over the worldly meaning today, and of course the biblical meaning as well for those. So, you know, so hold your horses. So words like adding, subtraction, taking away, or we know it's again subtraction, or multiply, or multiplying, if you will. All right, so let's deal with a little simple terms first, because this stuff is really simple. All right, define, add. First, let's deal with add. As we see here, of course, dealing with mathematics, all and one man. What does it got to do with anything? It is very relevant to what we're going to be going over first. So we got to understand simple words first, from the worldly and the biblical aspect. And at that point, I want to believe that the anti-poly people would kind of see that they are erring in different ways. Okay, so add. Join, which is, of course, is going to be very important later, because you got scriptures like Sefer Shemot, or the book of Exodus chapter 1, I believe it's the 10th verse, of course, dealing with the word join. So it says join something to something else so as to increase the size, number, or amount. All right, look at the words that is associated with it: attach, build on, add on, put in, if you will. These are words that are relevant to the word add. Okay, so now that we know that, let's deal with the word subtract. All right, subtract. All this is definitely important. All right, take away. That's going to be very important. All right, we're going to be dealing with that as well. And all this is going to be very important and very relevant to why I am speaking of this. But take away, you see, take away from, take off, deduct. All right, debit, abstract, discount. All right, take away something from something else so as to decrease the size, number, or amount. All this is, of course, relevant. All right, so we deal with add, we deal with subtract. Might as well do division. All right, division. All right, so division. So it says the action of what? Separating something into parts, or what we know as sections, or the process of being separated. All right, like a schisms, if you will. But look at other words to a disunion. That's when you're separating, you know, conflict. People separate from that. Discord, disagreement, dissension. People separate from these things. Disunity, you know, not unity, which is coming together. It's taking away, you know, going away, if you will. Not united, if you will. All of this is definitely relevant. So we deal with add, subtract, division. Let's deal with the word multiply. All right, multiply. Multiply. Deal with that. Multiply. So it says, dealing with mathematics, it says, obtain from a number another that contains the first number a specified number of times. All right, that is key there. Increase, or cause to increase what? Greatly in number or quantity. Increase, grow, breed, reproduce, procreate, propagate. All right. So this is dealing with enlarging, if you will, being exceeding, if you will. All of these things mean something, ladies and gents. Keep this in mind. All right. It all means something. All right. So again, we got the adding, subtract, division, multiply. All right, these are great examples. So let's get some biblical scriptures real quick dealing with these topics first, because all this is going to mean something's going to be very relevant to when we get back to Deuteronomy or Sefer Devarim shortly. Okay, so let's deal with Genesis 13:24. All right, let's deal with that. So it says, and she called his name Joseph or Yosef and said, the Lord shall add me another son. All right, let's click on add really quick. So we have Vatikra'et, Shemo Yosef, Lemor Yosef there. And the root word is Yosef, which you'll see later. And there's Yehoah, Li, Ben, Acher. All right, so now we have here, we go. We got Joseph, of course. Then we have Yosef right there. Boom. To add, increase, do again, to add, do again. Look at that, join. All right, all this means something here, ladies and gentlemen. It's going to be very relevant. Add, again, anymore. All right, see that? These all is going to mean something later. All right, for those who don't know the word Joseph. All right, in the same text. Yosef, all right? Look at this. Jehovah has what? Added. All right, meaning addition. All that means something. Let's go to Proverbs 30, and I believe it's verse 6. All right, it says, add thou not unto his words, lest he reprove thee, and thou be found a liar. There go the word add again. See that? All right, add. Same exact word, ladies and gents. To add, join. See that? Again. All right, all these things mean something. All right. So we're dealing with add, the word Exodus 1 and 10. Exodus 1, 10, it says, come on, let us deal wisely with them, lest they multiply. Oh, look at that word multiply. And it says, and it come to pass that when there fall out any war, they join them. They join also unto our enemies and fight against us, and so get them up out of the land. So now we see the word there, we see add, and we see the word multiply. That's going to be very important, ladies and gentlemen. All right. What we in? They're going to pass. We're going to fall into the war. Oh, here we go. Join. All right. Same word there, ladies and gents. Yosef. Yosef. Same thing, guys. That's what it actually is. Yosef. Add. Addition. All right, again, anymore. So we got this word add, right? Matter of fact, let's get one more. Jeremiah, all right, here we go, 45, and I believe verse 3, it says, thou didst say, woe is me now, for the Lord have what? Added grief to my sorrow. See that? I fainted in my sighing, and I find no rest. All righty, look at that. Added. Same thing. Same word there, ladies and gentlemen. All of this means something. So we got add. Now let's look at subtract. We'll get a few of those real quick. Numbers 4:13 real quick. Numbers 4:13, it says, and they shall what? Take away, meaning subtract, the ashes from the altar and spread a purple cloth thereon. All right, so now we have this here. Let's deal with that. Let's deal with the fat as one. But then we see that, take away. See that, ashes from, make wax fat. But it's dealing with what? Subtract as well. Taking away. All of this means something, ladies and gents. So we're dealing with subtract. Let's deal with First Chronicles. First Chronicles 7. First Chronicles 7 and verse 21. Let's go on down, boom. It says, and Zabad's son, and Shuthelah his son, and Azirah and Eliad, whom the men of Gath that were born in that land slew, because they came down and stole or take away their cattle. All right, it's gone down. So they stole something. I wish we know what your riders we have here. To go down, descend, decline, march down, sing. Oh, away we go. Bring a root to a lower region. It's dealing with lower, of course, to bring down, let down. All right. So, with that being said, all of this is dealing with, in that context, of course. Hold on, let me go back. All right. Sorry about that. That was the word Yerod. Here we go. Lachach. I apologize. Okay. Here we go. Take away. All right. So this is all dealing with what? Subtraction. Taking away. All right. That's the context of this actual verse here. So we got add. We got subtract. Let's see. Let's do some division really quick. Yeah, let's do that. All right. Let's see. Hebrew New Testament. All right, so we're going to go to here. Habsor HaKadosha Al Pi Yochanan Perek Yod. So we have the holy news according to the mouth of John. Perek, which is a chapter, Yod. So it's just 10. So St. John, chapter 10, and the, let's see, what does it say? Let's see, Avi, what he, okay, yeah, right here. Okay, this is the verse. Oh, hold up. About that? Right there. Boom. So it says, all right, I'll give you a chance to get there, ladies and gents. All right, so we once again went to St. John, chapter 10, and we're going to look at the 19th verse, ladies and gents. All right, so we have, but he mechalet. Right here, boom, right there. All right, you can see that, guys. So it says, Gam, Bepa'am Hazot, Ben Hachudim, Al Hadvarim Ha'ela. All right, so letting us know that, in short, that there was a division before again among the Jews, for these sayings. But let's see, let's go here. Ma ha loket, guys. Just want to say this slow. Ma ha loket. Why is that familiar, ladies and gents? Because we also see that word once again in what we know is the Hebrew text as well. Right here, ladies and gents. So in Ezekiel 48:29, it says, this is the land which you shall divide by lot unto the tribes of Israel for an inheritance, and these other portions. These are their portions, saith the Lord. All right, portions in the plural sense is machlechotam. All right, but when we click on that word there, here we go. Look at that. Mecholaket. Look at that, divisions. All right, so we're getting some dividing, if you will, section, like part or portion, if you will. So we're dealing with adding, subtraction, addition, all right, division. Now we're going to deal with multiply, because this, of course, is also relevant to Deuteronomy 17:17, ladies and gents. All right, so let's deal with multiply. Genesis chapter 3 verse 16. It says unto the woman, he said, I will greatly what? Multiply, not add, but multiply your sorrow and your conception. But that word multiply, all right, harba, all right. So el haisha amar harba, all right. So to the woman he said, Harba, all right. Harba arbe. So here we go, greatly multiply. But let's go ahead and click on that. Boom. word there is rava. All right. So look at this. That word means to become great, become many, become much, become numerous, many, numerous, multiply, make large, enlarge, increase, become many, take much, make many, have many. All this is going to be very important later. Look at this. Abundance or abundantly. See that? To increase. All right. All of these things is going to mean something. All right. Because look at this. Many. All right. Much. Very. See again, for a multiply. More. All right. Great or greater or greatly. All these things mean something. Look at this word, exceeding or exceedingly. Be full of. Look at this. Grow up, heap, increase, belong. Wow. So notice when we deal with add and the word multiply, we see there's a big difference. All right. Let's see, is there another multiple I want to get? Yeah, Genesis 1. I believe it's also in Genesis 1. Is it 20? No, 22, I think. And God blessed them in saying, be fruitful and what? And multiply and fill the waters in the seas and let the fowl multiply in the earth. So notice we see when we're dealing with adding, you know, addition to join, right? Build on, but this one here is greater than adding. This is many, much, exceeding. Ladies and gents, that is very, very important when dealing with this, guys. All right. Bless them saying, be fruitful and multiply. Look at this. Multiply, the same exact word. To become great, become many, become much, become numerous, long, great. Greater, if you will. All right. So adding is one thing, but multiplying is even greater, ladies and gentlemen. It's even greater. All right. Look at this. There is a word right there, multiply. Urvo, the root word is, matter of fact, let me see if I, oh, I can click on this. Hold on, wait a minute. Look at this. Rava or Rava.
Strong's H, 7235. Rava, Rava.
So now we know it. This right here has no dagish, you know. So when it takes a dagish, it takes the B sound or the bet sound. But you know, there's discrepancies in that. You know what I'm saying? But that's a whole nother topic, you know. So if you're saying Rava or Rava, great. All right. So we dealing with that word multiply. All right. Let's deal with another one. Genesis 6. And I think it's verse one. Go ahead, get your second to get that, guys. It says, and it came to pass when men began to not add, but multiply on the face of the earth, and the daughters of men were born unto them. All right, here we go. La Rov, which has the root word there, what? Multiply. Look at that.
Strong's H, 7231. Ravav.
All right. So to multiply, see that? Let's go ahead and click on down. Let's go ahead and go down real quick. Okay. Same thing, guys. Same, look at this. To become many or become much, become great. Look at this. To be become many, to be or become great, long. See that? To cast together, increase, especially in number, to multiply by the what? Myriad. Look that up, guys. Increase. Look, manifold, be more, multiply, 10,000. That is key there, ladies and gents. All right, that word multiply is dealing with in the thousands, guys. This here is this word multiply. And that's why I said it's good to know what these words mean. We're dealing with like math. So that's why I asked, are you good at math? You good at mathematical terms? Adding, division, subtraction, multiplication or multiply. Yeah, all that's going to mean something, ladies and gentlemen. Let's get another one. Genesis 17, verse 20 says, "And as for Ishmael, I've heard thee. Behold, I have blessed him, and I will make him fruitful, and will what? Multiply him what? Exceedingly. 12 princes shall he begat, and I will make him a great nation." So let's go ahead and click on that, ladies and gents. All right. Multiplying, exceeding, boom, boom, boom. Here we go, multiply. Sorry about that. Couldn't have had some trouble finding it. All right, same thing.
Strong's H, 7235. Rava.
Look at that.
Rava.
To become great, to become many, to become much, to become numerous. All this is going to make sense later, guys. But I want to show you these terms first. Become many, become numerous, multiply, to grow great, make large, all right, enlarge, increase, become many. If someone had 2, 3, or 4, or 5, that's not many, all right? That's not becoming enlarged, all right? But we're gonna deal with this later, guys. But I wanted you to see that words definitely matters, all right? Let's get Leviticus, all right? Leviticus, oh, hold up, sorry about that. Leviticus 26 in the 9th verse, it says, "For I have respect unto you, and make you fruitful, and multiply you, and establish my covenant with you." All right, multiply. What a vibe. Same thing.
Strong's H, 7235. Rava. Rava.
Notice that all of this is dealing with what? Becoming numerous, becoming much. All right, become many, many, all right, becoming many. First Chronicles, chapter 4, 27, it says, "And Shimei had what? 16 sons and 6 daughters, but his brethren had not many children, neither did their family multiply." Look at that. "Like to the children of Judah." Look at that. So he had 16 sons, 6 daughters, but it said that they didn't even multiply. Now, if you had 16, that's definitely adding. You had 6 daughters, that's definitely adding. But notice it said that even after all of that, it said that, but his brother had not many children, and a family didn't even multiply. Wow. Isn't that something? And a family didn't even multiply. All right, your family didn't even multiply. Here we go, multiply. Same thing, become many, become much, make large, increase, become many. Even though had 16 sons and 6 daughters, they still needed, that family didn't even become enlarged. They didn't become numerous. They become too many, exceeding, if you will. Ezekiel. 37, and I want to say 26. Let me make the covenant of peace. "Moreover, I will make a covenant with peace with them, and it shall be an everlasting covenant with them, and I will place them and multiply them, and will set my sanctuary in the midst of them forevermore." Let's go ahead and deal with that. All right, multiply. Look at that, guys. Same word there. Same word. To become numerous, much, many, enlarge, increase, become many, as you see, become great. See that? Let's get Job. Job 29. Still with the 18th verse, really quick. Job 29:18, it says, "Then I said, I shall die in my nest, and I shall multiply my days as the sand." Look at that. There go the word multiply once again. Multiplying the days. Same thing, guys. Look at this. As you see, I highlighted there. Becoming numerous. Becoming much. Becoming enlarged. Increase. Look at that. Greatly. Great. Many. Still with Deuteronomy. All right, Deuteronomy chapter 8. Deuteronomy chapter 8. Oh, hold on. Chapter 8. We're going to start in 10. It says, when thou hast eaten and art full, all right, full, it says, thou shalt bless the Lord your God for the good land which he had given thee. Beware that thou forget not the Lord your God and not keeping his commandments and his judgments and his statutes. He's telling him, look, don't forget which I command thee this day, lest when thou eaten and art full and hast built goodly houses and dwell therein, and when thy herds and thy flocks multiply, oh, and your silver and gold is multiplied. Sounds like a Deuteronomy 17, dude, which we'll do it later. And all that thou hast multiplied. So not in addition, but in a sense of multiplied. Look at that. It's the word Rabbah. Look at this. Look at that. When it's become numerous, exceeding. All right, let's go back, because all of this means something, guys. All of this means something. All right, so we see here that we have the word for multiply, guys. Look at this, yarbeh lach. Let me scroll down. Yeah. So we got that. All right, that being said, ladies and gents, let's go to online etymology dictionary. Let's deal with that as well. Once again, before we dive into this, all right, I need to drive this home that words mean something. All right, words definitely mean something. All right, so with that being said, let me see. Go boom. Division, the act of separating into parts, portions, or shares. We get that, ladies and gentlemen. Divisional, pertaining to division or division. Subdivide. See that? Further division. See that? So, to divide. Separate, dealing with portions. All right? So, we understand that, ladies and gentlemen. Let's deal with, multiply. They're going to wear multiply. Look at this. To cause to become what? Many. Cause to increase in number or quantity. Look at that. That's dealing with a lot. And rich. Look at this. Having many folds. To increase. But now we see this is in what? In quantities of being great. Alright? Being great. Multi. Multi means what? Many. Many times. Much. That's what multi means. Much or many. That's what multi means. All right. So when we're dealing with words like, multi-use, designed for different functions from multi, which is what? Many. See that? Look at that. Designed to be used more than once from multi in the sense of what? Many times. Still with, multiplex. Multiplex. It says what? Manifold, multiple. Look at this. Multiplicate. Having many folds, many times as what? Great in number of many parts. Multiple. Look at that. Multicolor. Deal with that. Also multicolored. Multicolored having what? Many or various colors. That's a lot. Many. Many colored. See that? All of these words mean something, ladies and gents. Now, when we deal with add, right? Hold on one second. Dealing with add. Add. To join. Doesn't that sound like Exodus 1 and 10 we deal with? Or unite. See that? Add to. Join. Attached. See that? So, addition, of course, is adding on, but it's not as much as that word multiply, if you noticed, right? Let's see. Look at this. The word add has a root word. Anything added, an increase or increment from the Latin, that says increase, but notice not in the sense of becoming enlarged or great or numerous, exceeding. Just like we know, subtract. All right. Withdraw, take away, deduct. All right. All of those dealing with subtraction. So now we know adding, subtraction, multiplication, right? All of this means something, ladies and gents. Definitely does. Just real quick, once again, the Unwritten Rules of Polygyny book can be purchased at propolybook.com, ladies and gents. Propolybook.com, the Unwritten Rules of Polygyny. Once again, it's a must get, full of information, ladies and gents. So we're going to go ahead and get on back to it and get on started, ladies and gents. As you already know, the YouTube channel is youtube.com/JudahTheShooter. All right, much love to all 809 subscribers. Once again, like, share, and subscribe, ladies and gents. That's youtube.com/JudahTheShooter. All right, so now, again, now that we done understood words such as division, subtraction, adding, and multiplying. All right, for example, for anybody out there that's a bit slow, you have, here's an example. You have addition, 8 + 8, 16. But 8 multiplied, another 8 is what? Not 16, but 64. That's multiplying. 4 + 5, that's 9. But 4 × 5 = 20, enlarged. You have 12 + 12, 24. But 12 × 12, or 12 multiplied by another 12, when you multiply that, it's no longer the same answer as 24. It's what? 144. All right. So there's a difference between adding, which is in addition, and to multiply, which is many, exceeding, if you will. All right, let's go ahead and get started. So we're going back to Sefer Devarim or the book of Deuteronomy. All right, going back to Deuteronomy real quick. Deuteronomy chapter 17, verse 17, ladies and gents. All right, Deuteronomy 17, 17. All right, so it says, neither shall he multiply, not add, ladies and gentlemen, not add, it didn't say add, wives to himself, that his heart turn out away, neither shall he greatly multiply. All right, so notice it's in the same context, to himself silver and gold. So he's basically saying he can't greatly multiply wives and greatly multiply to himself silver and gold. But that word multiply, let's look at that, rabah. Let's go ahead and click on that real quick. Matter of fact, hold on. Scroll back. Okay, here we go. See, greatly multiply. Alrighty. Why not showing up? Don't worry about that. I got you. You won't win that. Well, let me go ahead and put it here. All right, propolybook.com, Deuteronomy 17 and 17, ladies and gents. All right, so let's go ahead here, Deuteronomy 17 and 17. It says, and this shit gonna be multiply, boom. Let's click on it. If it allows, there we go, look at this. Much, abundance, increase, abundant. Look at that, ladies and gents. Hold on. Look at this. To become great, become many, or become much. Look at that. Become numerous, become many, become numerous, multiply people, animal, things, you know, giving examples. To grow great, to make large, enlarge, increase, become many. All right. Go down. Rava or Rava, increase. All right. Bringing, this is something that this word is means to bring it in by the what? Abundance. See that? That's what this is saying here. See that? It says enlarge, excel, exceeding, or exceedingly, to be full, make great, or greater, greatly, grow up, heap, increase, be long, See that? Many. That's what this is going into, ladies and gentlemen. Multiply, of course. Plenty. Look at that. Very. Once again, many. That's what this is going into, ladies and gents. But I'm going to show you for a man of reasonable doubt. Neither shall he multiply. This is talking, once again, numerous, exceeding, many. Not if a brother wanted two, if he wanted three or four. This is talking about many. And I'm far from done, because wait till we get the context of this. But I'm just dealing with the word multiply first. But then he say, multiply wives to himself, that his heart turn not away. Then it goes on to say, neither shall he greatly multiply to himself silver and gold. Does that mean he can't have more than one piece of silver and gold? Or this is talking about a whole bunch, many, too many, of course, overdoing it. This is not saying that he can't have more than one piece of silver. Look at the verse before that. But he shall not multiply horses to himself. Does that mean he can only have one horse again? No. Just means exceeding, enlarge. Too many, of course. That's what that means. Look at the word for multiply. Same thing, guys. It's the same thing. Rabah or Rabah. The Unwritten Rules of Polygyny. ProPolyBook.com is where you can find that book. But as you see, multiply. So it says, but he shall not multiply horses to himself, nor cause the people to return to Egypt, to the end that he should multiply horses. For as much as the Lord hath said unto you, you shall henceforth return no more that way. So again, we're seeing that word multiply. And we're seeing that it means exceeding, many. In other words, like overdoing it, much, numerous. That's what that means, ladies and gentlemen. So what I want to do is, we see here in the Deuteronomy 17:17, ladies and gents. Let's get some other versions really quick. Let me take this off really quick. 1 second. Let me take that off. Matter of fact, no, I'm going to keep that. Okay, I have a gateway. Let's see. Deuteronomy. Verse 17. All right, the first thing we're going to do is let's get what am I looking for? Is it on here? No, it's not. I got an idea. Hold on. Deuteronomy 17, verse 17. I want to get the Berean study Bible verse first. Okay. Yeah, here we go. Verse 17. Look at what it says here. He must not take, look at that, many wives for himself. Doesn't mean he can't take more than one. Just says he can't take many wives for himself. But we'll see later. This is what it's going into. All right. But then it says he must not accumulate for himself large amounts of silver and gold, ladies and gentlemen. That's what it's saying that he can't do. Let's get New American Study Bible. Standard Bible, that's what it's called. Alright. Look at this. It says, he shall not multiply wives for himself, or his heart will turn away, nor shall he greatly increase silver and gold for himself. Alright. So we're going to be going through different versions. Alright. Again, there's the word multiply. Multiply. Let's get, let's see, Christian Standard Bible. Look at this. He must not acquire many wives. That's what they're saying, guys, for himself. Look at that. Many wives is what that is right there. He must not do that. That's what they're saying. Let's get another one. here we go. The Holman Christian Standard. He was not acquired what? Many wives for himself. Same thing. Look at this. He was not acquired very large amounts of silver and gold for himself. That's what that's talking about. That's not saying more than one. That's talking about many, exceeding numerous. That's what that's going into. Let's get another one. So look at that. He shall not have what? Many wives. Many. Many. That may allure his mind, nor immense sums, meaning lots of silver and gold. Look at that. Let's get another one. Modern English version. Let's see what that one says. Look at that. What's the key word there? Many. Many. Excess. Let's get another one. All right. New English translation. Furthermore, he must not marry what? Many wives. Let's click on that. He must not multiply. Look at this. Must not take many. It's even right there. Look at this. From the Hebrew. Oh, that's what that's saying right there. He must not take many. That's what that means, guys. That's what it means. That's what the word multiply means. That's not saying he can't have two wives, three or four, five or six. That's talking too many, exceeding numerous. But we'll see later, if you haven't caught on yet, who that's talking about. Isn't that something? Oh, we getting somewhere. Let's go ahead, keep going. Let's see. I guess we'll do this one. See what this one say. He should not multiply wives for himself. Let's click on that. That's where nor. Or else his heart will turn away, nor shall he greatly increase silver and gold for himself. Okay. So right here again, it's the word multiply. All right. Now let's go down some more. Let's go ahead and click on that. He was not acquired what? Many wives for himself. Look at that. See that? Look at this. He was not acquiring great quantity for himself. That's what that's talking about. Let's look at the complete Jewish Bible. Likewise, he is not to acquire many wives for himself. That's what that's talking about, y'all. Look at this. He is not to acquire excessive quantities of silver and gold. All the other different versions know and understand what it's saying. Even the Hebrew text is expressing that. Let's get another one. Let's see. Let's do this one here. Look at this, guys. Same thing. He was not acquired many wives for himself. It was hard to turn away. Also, seven gold. He was not acquired in what? Great quantity for himself. Great quantity for himself. New Life Version. Look at this. He must not take many wives for himself. Look at this. Oh, his heart may turn away. He must not gather much silver and gold for himself. For himself, of course. That's what this is talking about. Contemporary English. Let's try that one. I don't think we did that one. Look at it. And the king. Oh, we're getting somewhere with this. Must not have what? A lot of wives. Oh. They might tempt him to be unfaithful to the Most High. Finally, the king must not try to get huge amounts of silver and gold. A lot of wives. Look at this. A king would often marry the daughter of another king. See that? Look at that, ladies and gentlemen. So, look at that. A lot of wives. Does that mean a brother can't have two wives, ladies and gents? Huh? That's talking about a lot. And this is talking about a king. Oh, we're going to deal with the excuses that people say when dealing with this too. But I just want to show, of course, in different versions, it's not talking about what they think that it's talking about. All right. Even children can understand this. Let's see. Speaking of children, the king must not have many wives. Look at that. If he does, his heart will be led away from God. He must not have what? Too much. They go to that word exceeding, numerous, too much, many. That's what this is implying. Can't have too much silver and gold. Wow. That's what this is talking about. Let's look at the Good News translation. Let's see what that say. The king is not to have many wives, because this would make him turn away from the Lord. He is not to make himself rich with silver and gold. We know that's what? Too much. Wow. Let's get another one. NLT version. Let's see what that say. The king must not take many wives for himself. Look, you see the same thing. And he must not accumulate large amounts of wealth, silver and gold for himself. This is why I ask, are you all good at math? Do you know math terminology? Such as adding, subtracting, division, and multiply or multiplication? Because if you do, you know that there is a difference in them all. There's a difference in them all. See what this version say. The king must not have many wives, or his heart would be led away from God. Look at this. He is not to have too much silver and gold. You gonna same thing. Same exact thing. Look at the Common English Bible. The king, well, look at this, must not take numerous wives. They go away numerous, as I was telling you. Look at this. Nor can the king acquire too much silver and gold. Too much. Mess around, have money is God. So notice in different texts, different versions. Look at that. So, matter of fact, let's go to another one really quick, ladies and gents. That's on my eye. Sorry about that. All right, so, no. Tripping. Matthew 27 and 55. Alright, here we go. Visham Nashim Ravot, right here. Nashim, which is women or wives, is Matthew 27:55. Then we have the word Ravot, which is the root word Ra'av, or Rav, as you saw earlier. And this here says many women or many wives. Let me copy that real quick for you guys so you can see I'm just talking crap. Translate Hebrew to English. Let's click on that. Boom. Many women. Now the word Nashim can also mean wives as well. Alright, depending on the context, just like or both, or the word rob can mean many, much, and large. Alright? So, as you see, I just took it out. Rob, many women, or many wives, of course. But let's go ahead and deal with that. Matthew 27. Let's click on it in English real quick, ladies and gents. Alright, verse 55. There you go. And many women. See that? Many women. All right. Now, in Greek, the word many is the word palus, where you get poly from. All right. Palus. I actually talked about this in a video, too, anyway. And then you have une, which is wife. See right here? For many, you have, like, you take the sigma off, and you have what? Poly. See that? Poly. Then you have the word une, and this is where you get Jenny from. Jenny, not to be confused with polygamy. Those are two different things, two different words. All right, and I did a lesson on this already. If you need the lesson, just let me know. I talked about this already. RoughPilotBook.com once again. Ladies and gents, it's where you get the book, The Unwritten Rules of Polygyny. That's where you get the book from. Now, what I want to do is I want to address the things that the sister was saying. One of the sisters said, because once again, she is one of the reasons why I decided to go ahead and just do the video now. And it's not personal, sis, you know what I'm saying? But as I told you, I was definitely going to be doing a response, you know what I'm saying? So, not personal. Peace and blessings to you. But I know if you're thinking this, a lot of other sisters are thinking this. And I know that you're probably teaching other sisters this, or you probably learned this from somebody else. Specifically another man. I seen the camp that you associated with, and I know they're anti-poly, so you probably learned it from them. You know what I'm saying? Maybe you didn't. Maybe this is something that you came up with on your own. You figured it was a divine revelation. Who knows? But we're going to go ahead and address it anyway. All right, so one of the things I want to talk about, and I might have to do different videos because it was a long conversation between her, a brother who I know, and another guy, and I don't know him. But I may have to break it up in sections. I definitely may do that. But the first thing first I want to address first, one of the comments, I did laugh at this because I thought that was clever, but, you know, it just let you know that people just be reading, speed reading, just be throwing stuff out there and maybe hoping that somebody's not going to fact check it or maybe not understand it. But this is a generation where people are now reading and we are now understanding what the script is actually saying. All right, in proper context. All right, so let me see. Here we go. I got it here on the phone. I don't know if you can see that. Yeah, there we go. All right. She also said 1 Corinthians 7. Let's go ahead and grab that real quick. 1 Corinthians 7 and 29. Now her discussion, we're gonna grab 1 Corinthians 7. She asked about verse 29. And she said, make this make sense with multiple wives. So this is the verse that she had used. 1 Corinthians 7 and 29, which is a verse that you've definitely seen me use as well in several lessons. But this is the verse here. I'll go ahead and let you read it real quick because her reply was after this verse, make this make sense with multiple wives. So yeah, let's go ahead and deal with this. So verse 29, it says, but this I say, brethren, all right? Notice you refer to us brothers, all right? Because that's going to be important later. But brethren, take a mental note of that. Not king, but brothers. The time is short, all right? Meaning we don't have a lot of time, guys. All right? And you know what this reminds me of too? Real quick, before I address that, Revelation 12:12. That's what this reminds me of. It says, therefore rejoice, ye heavens, and ye that dwell in them. Woe, meaning warning unto the inhabitants of the earth and of the sea. For the devil has come down to you, having great wrath, because he knoweth that he hath but a short time. That's what that reminds me of. But let's go back, 1 Corinthians 7, all right, and verse 29, now that we know the verse in question here. But here we go. She wants to know, how do you make sense of this with having more than one wife? Make this make sense. How can you have more than one wife? And she wants this verse to be expounded upon, explained. So it says, for this I say, brethren, that the time is short. All right. I mean, we ain't got enough. We ain't got a lot of time, you know. And as you see, one reason why, Revelation 12 and 12, it says that both they that have wives be as though they had none. So she wants to know, how do you make this make sense? Well, first off, words mean things. So when it says be as, meaning be just like those who don't have any, meaning like we don't have a lot of time. So those of you who have wives, y'all need to act like as if you didn't, like act like, be like those that are not. Obviously, they have wives, as we see. But it said you need to be moving as those who don't have wives. Why? Because when you go back, we're dealing with the context dealing, of course, with the kingdom. This, the word of the Most High comes first. So brothers, this comes before your wives, all right? So when it comes to this, it needs to be as if you didn't even have a wife. It needs to be as if you were single. This ain't saying that a brother can't go and take a wife or more than one wife. It just says that those that have wives, they need to be as those who didn't. Let's get some other versions. For example, let's look at the GNT real quick. Okay, here it says, what I mean, my friends, is this. It says, there's not much time left. And from now on, married people, this will be poly or monogamous, should live as though they were not married. Is that saying that he can't get married? No. It just says if you are married, you should live as if you're not. Why? Because it ain't a lot of time left. It's not a lot of time left. Let's get another one. Let's see. Here's a good word translation. Let's see. It says, this is what I mean, brothers and sisters, that the time has been shortened. While it lasts, those who are married should live as though they were not. That's what that's just saying. You should live as if you're not. So brother, if you got one wife, or brother, if you got 15 wives, you should be living as if you don't have a wife. You should be living as if you were not married. It doesn't say you can't get married at all. You should be living as if you don't have them. All right, let's get another one. Let's get the children's Bible. International Children's Bible. Brothers, is what I mean. We do not have much time left. So starting now, those who have wives should use their time to serve the Lord as if they had no wives. That's what I was telling you earlier. You know, this gospel, you know, dealing with the kingdom work. All right? It should be as if you don't have a wife. All right? Make time for this. Why? Because we don't have a lot of time. You know? So, that being said, let's go back to the KJV. For this I say, brethren, that the time is short, it remaineth. It says that both they that have wives be as though they had none. That's all that's saying. That's nothing to do with a person can't be poly. That's nothing to do with it. He wasn't even talking about that. In chapter 7, it wasn't even a battle of monogamy and polygyny anyway. You know, because, you know, a lot of people use 1 Corinthians 7 and 2, and I did a lesson on that, clearing up a lot of the misconceptions right here. 1 Corinthians 7 and 2, his own wife. And you see, I did that over a year ago, as you see right here. So it's not even talking about that. But people, of course, twist Paul's letters and try to make something out of nothing. All right. The 1 Corinthians 7, that chapter wasn't even talking about monogamy only or poly only, or you can't do monogamy and teaching against poly. It wasn't even talking about that at all. All right. So I wanted to deal with that. Another thing she said was, let me see if I did. Okay, yeah. Get to the good stuff. So dealing with the Deuteronomy 17 and 17. Hold on. Deuteronomy 17, verse 17. Neither shall he multiply, not add, but multiply wives to himself, that his heart turn not away. Neither shall he greatly multiply to himself silver and gold. So she said was, let's see what she said here. She asked him questions. She said, are you not a king or a god on this earth? Are you not by birthright supposed to be in rulership? Then she said, how can you ever get ready for that type of mindset if you don't walk in that mindset now? I said, this is, of course, one of her arguments that she's saying to the brother. And again, this is no offenses, but this is definitely a bit laughable that a person, of course, would try to get that desperate and try to use a play on words to justify a doctrine that doesn't even exist in the Bible. It doesn't exist. There's no scripture that one can use to try to show that having more than one wife is a transgression in the eyes of the Most High. It just don't exist. That's why a lot of people, they reach. And then when you ask them certain questions, they duck your questions, and you know how it goes. Preach you a long sermon, if you will. But let's go back and do what you said. He said, are you not a king or a god on this earth? So, are you not a king or god on this earth? So let's get some examples of what the people in the Bible called a fellow believer, if you will. Can we do that? Because one of the things she said was, get ready to become the king that you already are. So I first want to deal with, let's go to, change my screen. We're going to be dealing with that later too. Matthew 23, verse 8. All right. It says, but be ye not called a rabbi. Rabbi, for one is your master, even Christ, and all you are brothers. So that's the first thing I want to deal with. The Messiah said, we are brothers. All right. We are all brothers. Okay. Let's grab Acts 10. Let's deal with the story of Peter and Cornelius. Acts 10. You get there real quick. I'll start in 25. It says, and as Peter was coming in, Cornelius met him and fell down at his feet and worshipped him. But Peter took him up and got him up, saying, stand up. I myself also am a man. He could have said, yeah, I'm a king. Stay on down there. But he said, I myself also am a man. That's what he told him there. That's what he told him. I'm a man. What about Paul? Acts 21. Acts 21:37-39. So as Paul was to be led into the castle, he said to the chief captain, may I speak unto thee? The captain said, can you speak Greek? It says, art now thou that Egyptian, which before the days made is an uproar and led it out into the wilderness, 4,000 men that were murderers? But Paul said, I am a man. Which I'm a Jew, meaning an Israelite of Tarsus, a city in Cilicia. So we see that he was a Roman citizen. A citizen of no mean city. And I beseech you, meaning I beg of you, suffer me or allow me to speak unto the people. And when he had given him license or permission, Paul stood up on the stairs and beckoned with the hand unto the people. And when there was made a great silence, he spake unto them in the Hebrew tongue or language, saying, and then of course chapter 2 goes and says, men and brethren, if you will. But I want to show that Colossians as well. Colossians chapter 1. Let's grab that real quick, ladies and gents. Colossians chapter 1, verse 6. Says, which is coming to you as it in all the world, that bringeth forth fruit, as it does also in you. Since the day you heard of it, and knew the grace of God in truth, as you also learned at Epaphras, our fellow what? Servant, look at that, who is for you a faithful minister of Messiah, a Mashiach of Christ. Look at that. 1 Corinthians 10. 1 Corinthians 10, verse 1. It says, moreover, who? Brethren. He's addressing his fellow believers as brothers. So if I not, I wish not that you were ignorant. Mean without information, how that all our fathers, meaning ancestors, were under the cloud and all passed through the sea, which is talking about what? The Red Sea. It says, and were all baptized unto Moses in the cloud and in the sea. But look at right here. He called them brethren. Brethren. Chapter 12, verse 1. Now concerning spiritual gifts, who? Gifts, who? Brethren. I would not that you should be without information. I would not that you should be without information. Let's go to the book of James. Chapter 1, verse 1. James, what he called himself? A king of God? No. A servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ, of Yeshua Mashiach, to the 12 tribes which are scattered abroad. Shalom, meaning greeting. And James in the Hebrew text is Yaakov, I believe. Yeah. Yaakov Aver Elohim V'Adonenu. Yeshua HaMashiach. Yeah. She'el Lishalam Shanim. Asar Hash Batim. Then we have the word Shah Begola. So here we go, Yaakov, which is Jacob. All right. So, anyway, we got that. What about the book of Jude? Chapter 1, verse 1. Jude, look at that. The servant, Yeshua HaMashiach, and brother of James. To them that are sanctified by the Father, by God the Father, that preserved in Yeshua HaMashiach, and called. Mercy unto you, peace and love be multiplied. Look at that word, multiplied. Let's look at that real quick. Hold on. Multiplied order. Abundance. Abundance. Look at that. Rahmin, Mashalom, Bahrawa, Bayhi Lachem, Lamachabir. Absolutely. In abundance. A lot exceeding. Wow. So, ladies and gents, what about Revelation? Yeah, Revelation 1:1. The revelation of Yeshua Mashiach, Jesus the Christ, which God gave unto him to show unto who? His servants. Servants. Things which must surely come to pass, and he sent and signified it by his angels unto who? His servant, John. His servant, John. Go to Revelation 19:10. Says, and I fell, talking about John. He says, and I fell at his feet and worship him, talking about this angel. And he said unto me, see thou do it not. I am thy what? Fellow servant. Oh, let me take it off this real quick. Verse 10 again. He says, I am your fellow servant of your who? Brethren. See, that's what he said. At a testimony of Yeshua, worship the Father, God. For the testimony of Yeshua is the spirit of prophecy. So that's what he told him. I'm just a brother. I'm just a fellow servant. That's what I am. That's what I am. Revelation 22. What is it? 22. Verse 9. It says, then said he unto me, see thou do it not. No. I'm tripping. I already read that. What was the other one? Well, forget about it. So yeah, as I was saying, look, I'm a brother. I'm a brother. All right. Now, dealing with that, let me go back and see. Hold on, let me go back. Are you not a king or a god in this earth? That's what I want to deal with. Yeah, Psalms 82, really quick. That's a verse that, of course, is highly misunderstood. Psalms 82. Let's go to that real quick. But she asked, are you not a king or a god on this earth? That's what she asked. So what most don't know is that Psalms 82, wait, really quick, before I even deal with that, Exodus 21. So I'm going to deal with Exodus 21. So in Exodus 21, as you know, I did a lesson on this. Verse 5, it says, and if the servant shall plainly say, I love my master, my wife, and my children, I will not go out free. Then his master shall bring him unto the judges. Key word. He shall bring him to the door or to the doorpost. His master shall bore his ear through with him all, and he shall serve him or work with him forever. I did a lesson on this already on my channel. So definitely check that out, guys. But notice this is with the word judges right there. Let's click on that. Look at what we have there. Elohim. Elohim. Isn't that the word for God? As well? Isn't that the word for God, ladies and gents? Yeah, it is. So, now with that being said, let's go to Psalms 82. Let me go there real quick. Come on, Psalms. There we go. Psalms 82. All right, Psalms 82. Now, when it says, I have said you are gods, and all of you are children of the Most High. All right, we go down and we see once again, it is what? Elohim. Elohim, gods, right? Magistrates. You mean angels, exceeding God, right? It can mean judges as well. All right, matter of fact, real quick, 1 Samuel. Is it 1 Samuel? Yeah, 1 Samuel 2:25. Says here, And if one man sin against another, the judge shall judge him. All right? And if a man sin against the Lord, who shall entreat for him? Notwithstanding, they hearken not unto the voice of their father, because the Lord will slay them. But let's look at that word judge, because it said the judge will judge them. Elohim. That's what you brothers say. Elohim, if you will. So, going back to Psalms 82 and verse 6, the true context of that is just saying, your judges. That's basically what he's saying there. But look, let's look at verse 1. God standing in the congregation of the mighty. Look at this. He judges. All right? Don. He judges among the gods, or the judges. He judges among the judges is what they're saying. How long will you judge, all right, unjustly? How long will you make the decisions unfairly, in other words, and accept persons of the wicked? Selah. So this is dealing with showing favoritism. But it says, because you know, in righteousness shall you what? Judge a neighbor. It says, defend the poor, the fatherless, do justice to the afflicted and needy. Deliver the poor and needy, like help them. Rid out of the hand of the wicked. It says, they know not, neither will they understand. They walk on in darkness. All the foundations of the earth are out of course. I have said you are judges. That's what he means there. And all of you are children of the Most High. But you shall die like men and fall like one of the princesses. Arise, O God. Meaning, arise, O judge. And he's saying in judge, which is done. Let me click on that. All right. Shaphat. Yep. Mm-hmm. Right there, to judge. So he says, arise, O God, meaning judge, and judge the earth. For thou shalt inherit all nations. And one day we will have power over the nations. All right. One day. So dealing with that, that is technically the actual context of what that actually means, if you really want to be technical. So when she asks, are you not a king? Well, I'm a fellow servant. I'm just a brother. I'm just dust and ashes. Or God on this earth? Yeah, we are judges. But she also asks, are you not by birthright supposed to be in rulership? Yeah, by birthright, we supposed to be. Supposed to be is the key word. But of course, you already know Deuteronomy 28, 15 to 68. Yeah. You already know Daniel chapter 9, verse 9 on down to 15, what happened. So, yeah, by birthright, we supposed to be. But of course, what happened? What happened to the children of Israel? What happened to us? What we do? What did our forefathers do? They sinned against our Heavenly Father. So therefore, yeah, you can't use that either as a crutch. But when she asks, how can you ever get ready for that type of mindset if you don't walk in that mindset now? So she's obviously knowing that we are, of course, later on would, of course, have that that kingship, if you will, later on. Yeah, so today a brother may say, what's up, king? Shalom, king. Some brothers may say, shalom, queen. Shalom, empress. Shalom, princess. You hear all of that. But that's another topic, though. But anyway, brothers do have that mindset now. However, when it comes to this script, we know how it's supposed to be. How we should be. 1 Peter 5. Humble yourselves. Not exalt yourselves, but humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of the Most High, that he may exalt you in what? In due time. Due time here is coming. In due time. It will be. In due time. You know what I'm saying? But just like we know in the people in the Bible, everybody who were kings didn't have more than one wife. Just like every regular person. You know what I'm saying? It's vice versa. So, in due time. Due time. Matthew. Let's go back to Matthew. 23, verse 12. He says what? And whosoever shall exalt himself shall be humbled. In other words, brought low. And he that shall humble himself shall be exalted. So that's going to happen in due time. We got Sirach 3. Or Ecclesiastes chapter 3. All right. Let's see. Yeah, here we go. So it says, the greater thou art, the more humble thyself, and thou shalt find favor before the Most High. Many are in high place, and of renown, meaning famous, he's known, but mysteries are revealed unto the meek. So the power of the Lord is great, and he is honored of the lowly. So we should be morally thinking lowly first, humbly, if you will, if you really want to be technical. You really want to be technical. So when you ask those questions, sis, nice try. Nice try. You know what I'm saying? So whether if a person is in that mindset or if he's not in that mindset, at the end of the day, we brothers. You know what I'm saying? If we talking king isn't a real king, you know what I'm saying? It's in like how the scriptures, a melech or a malach, one who rules, one who reigns. This is a person that has an actual kingdom, if you will. You know what I'm saying? So, for example, you got the first king of Israel was who? Saul. You know what I'm saying? So, I don't know if you all know that, but Saul was the first king over Israel, the first literal king. It's not talking figuratively. All right. So, with that being said, let's go to Deuteronomy real quick. Deuteronomy chapter 17. And we'll start back in 14. Look at what it says right here. Laws concerning Israel's kings. All right. This is not to be confused with all Israel. Why? Because it said Israel's kings, meaning rulers, one who reigns. So it says, when thou art come unto the land. See you right there, sis? Because remember, you just tried to use verse 17. But notice one of the key words is when we came to the land. Let me highlight that. So, are we in our land right now? No. But it says, which the Lord your God giveth thee, and thou shalt possess it. That means own it. Right now, we don't own our land. And dwell therein. We're not even living in our land. Those are key words right there. And shall say, I will set a king over me. Over who? The key word is me. So I'll let you know, everybody isn't, this is talking about a physical king. But it says, like as all the nations that are around about me, meaning that's surrounding me. Here's the command. You shall in any wise set him king over who? You. So we know this is talking about a physical king, not a person who's calling himself king. It says, whom the Lord your God shall choose. One, not all of y'all, but one from among who? Your brethren. Key word there, your brethren. Shall you set king over who? You. So this is the one who's ruling over you. So you may as not set a stranger, meaning a foreigner, over you, which is not you, your brother. Verse 16. But he, talking about the king, shall not multiply horses to himself. So meaning he shouldn't be getting numerous horses for himself. He shouldn't be doing it exceedingly or abundantly. Didn't say he can't have more than one, but he can't do it abundantly, exceeding, numerous, too much, over much, if you will. Because the difference between adding, subtracting, division, and multiplying. Multiplying is when you're enlarging. It's saying he shouldn't enlarge that. Not too many. But then he say, nor cause the people to return to Egypt. What people? The Israelites. Says, to the end that he should what? Multiply horses. That's talking what? A whole bunch. Remember, 4 + 5 = 9. But 4 × 5 is what? What's 4 × 5? 20. So it says, for as much as the Lord hath said unto you, you shall henceforth return no more that way. Verse 17. Neither shall he. Who's the he? Remember, this context is dealing with what? Law concerning kings. Literal kings, not people who are calling themselves kings, but literal kings. But it says, neither shall he multiply wise unto himself. Now we learned earlier, this is talking about too many, much, exceeding. That's what this is talking about, too many wives. Not, it's not saying he can't have more than one, but it's talking too many, much, exceeding. It says that his heart turn out away. Neither shall he greatly multiply to himself silver and gold. I mean, he can't have too much, too many. Here we go. And this shall be when he sitteth upon the throne of his what? Kingdom. So this is how you know this is talking about a literal king, a physical king. That's the context. So this is talking about a king when he sit up on the throne, when the children of Israel go into the land to possess it and dwell there. And now remember, the first king over Israel was Saul. So we know this is a bit of a future prophecy. Why? Because we know that there were no kings during this time when the children of Israel were in the wilderness. There wasn't a king at this time. So this command was, of course, when the children of Israel, of course, living in the land when they owned it. Because ask yourself, who was a king during the time of Moses, during the time of Joshua? Hell, that was a time we didn't have judges at one point. So when was the first king established over the Israelites? That was Saul, King Saul. So that's how we know, again, this is talking future. This is when we were in the land. That's what this commandment is dealing with. But it said, and it shall, future tense, and it shall be when he sit upon the throne of his kingdom, that he shall what? Write him a copy of this law in a book. It says, out of all that which is before the priests, the Levites. There is another clue, because he had to do it before the Levites. Are we under the Levitical priesthood anymore? No, absolutely not. We're not under the Levitical priesthood anymore. Christ is now that high priest. So there isn't a priesthood set up at all. No one's sacrificing animals anymore. Huh? Come on now. So then it say, and it shall be with him, and he shall read therein all the days of his life. Every day. It says that he may learn to fear the Lord his God and to keep the words of this law and these statutes to do them, that his heart be not lifted up above his brethren. Oh, so if we are all supposed to be kings, and who's his brethren then? Because obviously, whoever this king is, he's ruling over his brothers. But it's saying that he should write a copy of this law before the priests, the Levites, read it every day, and so they can keep the words of the law and do them, and that his mind or heart be not lifted up above his brother, meaning that he don't be prideful, thinking that he's too much better than everybody. It says, and he turned on his side from the commandment to the right hand or to the left to the end, that he may what? Prolong his days in what? In his kingdom. He and his children in the midst of Israel. Look at that. So now we know that this is talking a literal king, sis. So nice try. You can't use your ideology to try to create a doctrine that doesn't exist. And that's why I highlighted key words there. Let's go here. Let's see. Look at this. Verse 17. And he is not to have what? A great number of wives. Didn't say he can't have more than one. For the fear that his heart be not turned away, or great wealth of silver and gold. Look at this. Go back to verse 16. He is not to get together a great army of horses for himself. That's all that that's saying. Or make people go back to Egypt to get horses for him. Because the Lord has said, you will never again return back that way. Says, and he is not to have a great number of wives, for that his heart be turned away. Look at this, a great wealth of silver and gold. That's what that's talking about. And when he is taking his place on the seat of his kingdom, some of his throne. Look at that. Right there. That's what that's talking about. Now, you know I did the lesson on King Solomon already, dealing with that in 1 Kings 11 chapter, so you might want to definitely check the lesson out that I did too. I talked about that as well. I think I talked about it on what video was that? Let me see. Because it's at youtube.com/JudahTheShooter. I think it's in this one, is the Polygyny of Sin video. It's in that one. I talked about King Solomon. So definitely check that out. So go back. Let me see if she said anything else. Hold on, that I want to deal with in this particular video. Yeah, so again, whether a person is calling himself a king, a judge, a lord, if he's calling himself a brother, Morim, which is teacher in teachers in Hebrew, or Morey, which is a teacher in singular, no matter what he's calling himself, at the end of the day, we all know and understand what it is, and we know and understand that Deuteronomy 17:17 was dealing with a literal king that set up on the throne, and it was future prophecy. Because of course Saul was the first king, and that wasn't all the way into like 1 Samuel, the 9th chapter. So dealing with that, they know and understand what it is, ladies and gents. They know and understand that this is not talking about what people trying to make it talk about. This ain't saying that a person can't have more than one wife. That's not saying that at all. It's not saying that. You know what I'm saying? So dealing with that, I'm showing the screen. 1 Samuel, the 9th chapter, right here. Saul chosen to be king. You know what I'm saying? So, boom. And had a son whose name was Saul, a choice young man, and goodly. And there was not among the children of Israel a goodlier person than he. From his shoulders and upward, he was higher than any of the people. Now, of course, when you go to the 10th chapter, that's when it get on down to the meat of it. When you go to chapter 10, verse 17 on down. You know what I'm saying? So when you look at that, Saul was the first king over Israel. He was the first king over Israel. Let's start in 17. And Samuel called the people together unto the Lord to Mizpeh, and said unto the children of Israel, thus said the Lord God of Israel, I brought up Israel out of Egypt, and delivered you out of the hand of the Egyptians, and out of the hand of all kingdoms, and of them that oppressed you. It says, and you have this day rejected your God, who himself saved you out of all your adversaries and your tribulations. And you have said unto him, nay, meaning no, but set a king over us. Don't that sound like Deuteronomy 17? Now, therefore, present yourselves before the Lord by your tribes, by your thousands. You know what I'm saying? So dealing with that, when you read 17 on down, you get the gist of what that's being said. This is talking about a literal king. Deuteronomy 17 ain't talking about what people make it, trying to make it seem, because look, even here in Deuteronomy 17, right? When dealing with this, right? The 17th verse. He is not to have a great number of wives, for the fear of his heart may be turned away. Of great wealth of silver and gold. Why is it that in 3 chapters later, it gives the laws of inheritance? Because the chapters is divided into different parts. Atonement for unsolved murders, that's dealing with 1-9. Marrying female captives, that's dealing with 10-14. When you went to war, you saw a beautiful woman, of course, and you desired to marry your wife. But then, of course, you got verse 15-17, deal with the rights of the firstborn, dealing with inheritance, things that are passed down, possessions. Then you got 18-21 is dealing with it. You had a rebellious son. Then you have 22-23 dealing with one hanging on the tree. You know, I talked about this already, of course. And you know, Christ is redeeming us from the curse of the law. Of course, being hanged up on a tree. Galatians 3:10-13. But anyway, verse 15, it says, if a man has what? 2 wives. So it's giving a specific amount. It's not talking about a person had 3, 4, 5, 6. Only if he's talking about 2. And it says let's see if he said that they were going to be punished, or if they were in sin, or if God was going to be angry with them. Because if a man has 2 wives, one greatly loved and another hated. It says, and of the 2 of them have had children by him, and if the firstborn son is the child of the hated wife, or the one who he loves less, verse 16, then when he gives his property, this is some of his inheritance, to his sons for their heritage, things that are passed down to them. It says, here's the commandment. But it's only if he had 2. And one he loved and the one he hated, love less. Kind of like a Rachel Leah thing. It says, he is not to put the son of his loved one in the place of the first son, the son of the hated wife. But look at it, here's the command. but he is to give. That is a command. He is to give his first son his birthright. And look at this. And twice as great a part of his property. For he is the first fruits of his strength, and the right of the first son is his. So you see that? He's the first fruits. Kind of like Christ. 1 Corinthians 15:23. Christ the first fruits. Another topic though. But dealing with the KJV is dealing with the same thing right there. This is dealing with rights of inheritance, property, things that are passed down, possessions. So why is it that in three chapters over, it talks about if a man had two wives? That's not multiple wives anyway. And then again, we know it's talking about a king. So with that being said, we know and understand that there has to be a difference between add and multiply. We know that from a worldly aspect to a biblical aspect, it's not the same thing. Similar, but not the same. Add, multiply. So, dealing with that, we see here, it's given a command to a man if he had two wives, and it was an if. If he had two, and one that he loved, and one that was loved less, hated. It scratched there. Why would it give that command and say that? Make no sense to me. So, this is the long story short. ProPolyBook.com. Remember, ladies and gents, we got the shoes. And, of course, we got the shirts to go with it. You know, and, of course, we got the jackets as well. Got the jacket. See, it's great quality. Boom. Because, you know, I got, now, for those who don't know, you might see my red jacket. I got a red jacket like this, too. And an orange one, too. I got an orange, too. Boom. See that? Oh, ProPolyBook.com. Look at that. ProPolyBook.com. Oh, yeah. You can get it from ProPolyBook.com, ladies and gents. The Unwritten Rules of Polygyny. ProPolyBook.com, ladies and gents. So people stop asking me, what's the link? How can I find the book? ProPolyBook.com, The Unwritten Rules of Polygyny. And I definitely want to say, ladies and gents, that if we are friends on social media, no matter if I know you, no matter if I know you, no matter if I don't know you, it's not personal. I don't care how long I've known you. That's not a personal page anymore. So in order to be on that friends list, you had at least first have to get the book from ProPolyBook.com, The Unwritten Rules of Polygyny. Don't matter who it is, it's not personal. People who I've known for a long time have been re-adding me back. But for some reason, they haven't been getting that message. And it's been on all my posts, it's been on all my videos, so you obviously haven't been keeping up with me. You obviously ain't picked the phone and called me. You obviously ain't pulled up or nothing like that. So understand, ProPolyBook.com. My social media is now a business page. It's not a personal page anymore. I got plans for that page, most high willing. And it only includes those, of course, who have the book from ProPolyBook.com only. Well, I got it from here. I got it from such and such and such. ProPolyBook.com. If I don't see your name on that list, it's not happening. It's not personal. Don't mean I don't deal with you. Don't mean I don't mess with you. You know what I'm saying? Now, people have been asking, Judah, are you a part of a Hebrew camp, a Hebrew group, anything like that? No. Not a part of no Hebrew group, no Hebrew camp. Not affiliated with nobody. Yeah, you know, sometimes I come around and mingle with brothers and things like that, but me and my wives, we are not affiliated with no group, no camp. When I say that, I mean, like, I'm not sitting up under nobody, studying up under nobody, nobody's elder or group, anything like that. There's no disrespect to anybody that is doing that, but that's just not us. Not doing that. Absolutely not. So I keep getting asked that, hey, what camp you with? What group you with? None. You know what I'm saying? That's just what it is. You know what I'm saying? So So no matter who you are, again, if you have not got the book from propolybook.com, then ladies and gentlemen, you can't get on the friends list. It's nothing personal. Now, you can re-add me after the fact, you know, after it is known, okay, you got the book. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, yeah, that's just what it is. So, anything else I want to say? Yeah, my wife's been dropping videos, so they got some heat coming, so definitely check out my wife's channel. If you don't know it by now, then you obviously ain't been keeping up. But it is in the book, though. Propolybook.com. Shalom.